KVL states that the sum of the electrical voltage, or potential differences, around any closed loop or path in a circuit is always zero. But why does the sum of the voltages amount to zero? Let's delve deeper to get a clearer picture. Consider an individual charge situated at our battery. This battery is rated at 5 volts, which essentially means the charge is endowed with an energy of 5 joules. Now, as this charge embarks on its journey around the circuit loop, it first confronts the resistor. To traverse this component, the charge expends a portion of its energy, translating to a voltage drop across the resistor. The charge continues its journey, next arriving at the LED. Here, too, it has to dispense some energy to move through, creating another voltage drop. Similarly, as it passes through the capacitor, further energy is spent. By the time our charge completes its loop and returns to the battery, it will have exhausted the entire 5 joules of energy it initially gained. This means that the sum of all the voltage drops across the components equals the original 5 volts from the battery, making the net sum zero, in accordance with Kirchhoff's voltage law. Now, there's an important observation to be made. Components like batteries or voltage sources impart energy to the charge, while other components like resistors, capacitors, and LEDs deplete that energy. To simplify our circuit analysis and keep track of these energy dynamics, there's a useful convention that we can employ. When analyzing circuits from left to right, in the case of batteries, if we traverse from the negative end and exit the positive end, it's considered as plus V. Conversely, entering from the positive end and exiting the negative end equates to minus V. In the case of capacitors, entering the positively charged plate and exiting the negatively charged plate, the voltage is accounted as minus Q over C, or minus V. However, if we move from the negatively charged plate and exit the positively charged plate, it's treated as Q over C, or plus V. In the case of resistors, if the current's direction aligns with our left to right analysis, the voltage drop is minus IR, or minus V. Should the current flow oppose our direction, the voltage becomes IR, or plus V. This systematic convention is crucial, ensuring that as we traverse the circuit, we are consistent in our voltage attributions, reinforcing the principles laid down by Kirchhoff's voltage law. Armed with our insights into how different circuit components transfer energy to charges, and our consistent voltage convention, we're well equipped to apply Kirchhoff's voltage law to a circuit analysis. Consider the following scenario. We're presented with a circuit that features two batteries in series, one supplying 5 volts and another offering 1 volt. This circuit also houses 3 resistors, R1 with a resistance of 5 ohms, R2 with 15 ohms, and R3 with 20 ohms. Now let us determine the current I flowing through this circuit and subsequently compute the voltage drop across each resistor. Let's delve in and use KVL to solve this. First things first, let's label the voltages across each component. Next, let's discern the direction of the current. Observing the two batteries, it's evident they counteract each other. Given the 5-volt battery has more strength compared to the 1-volt counterpart, we can infer the current will predominantly flow in a clockwise direction. Now, to apply KVL, let's traverse this loop clockwise, beginning from the bottom left of our circuit diagram. The first component in our path is battery B1. Adhering to our earlier established convention, we enter through its negative terminal and exit via the positive. Consequently, this interaction contributes a plus VB1 to our equation. Next, the component we encounter is the first resistor, R1. With the direction of current flow matching our analysis direction, and considering our convention, the voltage drop across this resistor will be negative. Given Ohm's law, V equals IR, we'll denote the voltage drop across R1 as minus I, multiplied by R1. Continuing our journey, we next come across the 1-volt battery. This time, we are moving from its positive terminal to its negative terminal. Using our earlier convention, this equates to a negative contribution, so we represent it as minus VB2. Next in line is the resistor R2. Similar to R1, since the direction of current flow aligns with our path of analysis, the voltage drop across R2 will also be negative. Thus, this becomes minus I times R2. As we proceed, we encounter the third resistor, R3. Again, the voltage drop across R3 due to the direction of current flow will be minus I times R3. Finally, completing our loop and returning to our starting point, according to Kirchhoff's voltage law, the sum of these voltages must equal zero. Mathematically, our KVL equation thus can be written as follows. With the given values for each component, we can now solve for the unknown current I. Finally, using the current, we can determine the voltage drop across each resistor as follows. Now, we can visualize the distribution of voltages across the circuit, which clearly illustrates the practical application of Kirchhoff's voltage law. As you go along and practice with more circuits of varying complexities, you'll find KVL to be an invaluable tool for circuit analysis. To wrap things up, Kirchhoff's voltage law is not just a theoretical principle but a practical guide that helps engineers and enthusiasts decipher complex circuits. Today, we've scratched the surface. As you dive deeper into the world of electronics, you'll encounter many situations where KVL becomes your go-to method. Thank you for joining us on this enlightening journey through circuit analysis. If you found this video beneficial, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more insights into the intriguing world of electronics. And as always, we appreciate your feedback, so drop your thoughts or questions in the comments below.